Good morning. Welcome, everyone. We have people attending from all over the world. We have a nice size registration this time, and we look forward to you all joining us today for what is the second TAG webinar, Embracing Cybersecurity in the Global Accountancy Profession Today and in the Future. I'm Robert Harris. I was a former IFAC board member and a partner at Raymond, and a member of the IFAC Technology Advisory Group. Today, I'll serve as the moderator for the webinar. Before we get started, I'd like to go over just a few items so you know how to participate in today's event. I've always believed that webinars are best if they're interactive, and so your questions are very important because if you're thinking about the question, I'm sure many others are. So you'll have a chance to submit the questions to the presenters by typing your question in the box in your GoToWebinar control panel. You can direct those to the individual or leave them as general, and we'll try to sort out who is best to answer them. So we'll address them at the end of each of the presentations. The session is being recorded and will be posted on the IFAC gateway, so you can promote it to your members and to your colleagues if you wish. In today's digital age, many people have at some point wondered whether their online accounts have been compromised or have been part of a large data breach. Like a lot of the issues that make the news on a regular basis, we can become desensitized to cyber risk, but it is imperative, especially for organizations of all sizes, to be vigilant and educate their employees and stakeholders on the proper protocols and procedures for minimizing risk. Accounting professionals are in a very unique position to address cybersecurity. Today, the IFAC staff has put together four very distinguished speakers who are with us right now, who will provide a range of insights on how cybersecurity is impacting business and accountancy profession and how accountants and their firms can respond. I am delighted to introduce Kristen Gillen, who is the technical manager at our friends at ICAEW in their IT faculty, George Quigley, who is a director at Fulcon Limited, Donnie Shimamoto, who is the founding manager and director at Enterprise Technologies, and Eric Askerson, who is the president and chief executive of CPA.com, and Mimi Blanco-Best at AICPA. So we'll get started this morning, and we will welcome Kristen, who will be discussing the state of cybersecurity and how fraud impacts organization. Kristen, I'll hand it over to you for now.
Thank you very much, Bob, and hello to everybody. So I'm going to start by talking a little bit about, firstly, the impact of breaches, and then to give a bit of a summary and a kind of snapshot of some of the challenges we see in the way that cybersecurity is evolving for businesses. In the IT faculty within ICAEW, we are the focal point for ICAEW's work around technology. And a key part of that has been cybersecurity. It has been for many years. Information security has kind of morphed into cybersecurity. So in many cases, there's nothing new, but of course it has gone up the agenda tremendously in recent years as we've just seen more and more breaches happen. So if we move on to the first slide, I wanted to talk and start by thinking about this idea of this range of attacks. And as Bob says, I think the key thing here is that this affects everyone. It's small organization, large organization, businesses, accountancy practices, every sector. This is something that is key. And it's often been quite difficult to get that message across because, of course, it's quite difficult to get people to share their stories and to make kind of these high level headlines and the statistics into something real. And that's what we need to hear. For many years, we've heard from our members things like, well, I don't have any particularly, you know, vital data. Why would I be attacked? No one's attacking me. And I think we've seen in recent years just personal experience and more example means that this is becoming more real to people. So just to give a flavour of some of the things we talk about, I'm starting with the British Airways breach, which was last year, which is kind of very typical breach that we see, a large company, customer data compromised. So this is particularly close to me because I was one of the affected customers. So I woke up one day to an email from British Airways saying, oh, your credit card details have been compromised. And what the attackers were doing was basically taking details from the website. When I booked a flight online, it was taking all my credit card details. So it had even the three-digit number at the back of the card, and they were then going to use those. So I got that email from British Airways. I think about 500,000 customers were impacted. And so in many cases, you know, one of the key impacts here is around reputation. Clearly, I worry about the extent to which British Airways is really looking after my data. So there's a big reputation impact, and that's been the case for a while. Interestingly, this case is one of the first that's being held under the new data protection rules in the EU and in the UK, GDPR, where regulators have suddenly got much bigger fines and bigger penalties, so up to 4% of global revenue for a major breach. So everyone's looking in great interest as to what kind of fine might be levied against British Airways under these new powers. And then finally, it's also subject to class action. So again, an interesting development is the sort of the big number that could come at the end of that and how much British Airways might have to pay. So traditionally, we've talked about reputational impact here, but increasingly these are potentially quite large numbers that are involved, which is certainly helping to focus the attention of boards and senior management and large companies. The second area is ransomware, and this is the kind of stuff that, again, organizations and individuals are just seeing much more of and having personal experience of. WannaCry was a very big example, high profile example, and again, it was very important in the UK because it affected our National Health Service. In total, 200,000 computers over 150 countries, but we saw real world impact. Hospitals shut, A&E departments shut, because people just switched their computers off, and we had nearly 20,000 hospital appointments cancelled. So real world impact. And equally, you know, for small businesses, this kind of business disruption can be absolutely catastrophic, really. There was a case of a hairdresser up in Glasgow, quite well known, that they were, because they were talking about it, they'd been affected by a ransomware attack. They paid the ransomware to try and get their data freed up. It hadn't worked. They'd not got their data back. And so they'd lost their entire customer database. They were asking their clients to come in and say when they had appointments, but they just lost all of their data. So for a small business, this kind of attack is pretty disastrous. And then finally, CEO impersonation. There's lots of different examples of this, but this really impacts our members, people working in finance function and professional services. So the typical example might be an email from a CEO purporting to come from a CEO asking for an urgent payment, bypassing the usual controls, and the finance person might feel pressured into doing it because it's from the CEO. But of course, it's a fraud. These things can be very, very sophisticated and very convincing now. And if you pay it, then, you know, there's financial loss. So this kind of stuff, again, a lot of our members are seeing and is having a real impact. So, you know, so it's affecting everyone. And what does that mean? If we move on to the next slide, what I wanted to just draw on was the key themes of our Audit Insights cybersecurity work, which is really research work we've done with the top six audit firms in the UK, drawing on the experience of their teams when they go in and do audit and assurance work, looking at cyber information security and just trying to pick up some common themes. As I said at the beginning, people don't want to talk about this stuff. There's issues about client confidentiality. So it's very difficult sometimes to really find out what's going on. So this was a way of getting through that and just coming up with some kind of key themes. And at the very beginning of the process, we came up with four themes that I think, you know, sort of summarize almost the changing sort of nature of cybersecurity and what's new about it compared to traditional information security. And the first one of those is that businesses need to consider cyber in all their activities. And this is, I guess, the key point, that it's not an IT issue. Often it's pigeonholed about IT. It's the responsibility of the CIO and the IT department, and it's all about firewalls and anti-malware protection. And then obviously, it is a lot about IT, but it's not an IT issue. It's a business issue. It has to be talked about as a business issue, integrated into business thinking. When you're looking at innovation, you know, right up front, when you're innovating with new products, how are you thinking about cybersecurity or mergers and acquisitions? What does that mean for cybersecurity? So this is not something that's just about IT. It has to be seen and integrated into the way the whole business operated. The second theme is really around the changing nature of security, and businesses need to accept that their security will be compromised. And maybe traditionally, when we talked about information security, we kind of focused very much on prevention. You could kind of lock your doors and keep your data safe. And in today's world where there's data on mobile devices, on clouds, outsourced, just all over the place, the idea you can keep your data safe all of the time is just not realistic. You know, there are going to be compromises, there are going to be breaches, and therefore businesses need to think much more broadly about detection, about response, about resilience, and develop a much broader set of processes of thinking around cybersecurity, and seeing it not just, as I said, about stopping things happening, but actually how you manage that whole process. And the third flag is linked to that, because if you can't protect everything all of the time, most organizations probably have some stuff they want to protect all of the time, whether it's IP or critical client data or personal information. Most people have critical information, their crown jewels, as we call them. And so that's really around taking a much more nuanced and risk-based approach to cyber, not thinking about data as a singular thing. And often when we talk about cyber, and a few years ago, businesses would have cyber risk as this kind of single thing. And it's trying to get away from that and thinking much more specifically about the risk of different types of data and classifying data and what's really important and where do you really want to invest your money and what, you know, is less important and, you know, you're just not going to be able to protect all the time. So it's taking a much more risk-based approach to thinking. And then finally, most businesses don't get the basics right. There's so much about security that's not new, and it's not rocket science. It's anti-malware, it's good passwords, you know, this kind of stuff. And yet so many businesses still just don't get that stuff right. And there's a lot of reasons for that. For large organizations, they have often really complicated IT estates, lots of hardware, software, suppliers, and just keeping all of that up to date is really hard. Small businesses often don't have the skills, the time, the priority, the experience to get it right. And so much of this is about people, and it's about changing behavior and changing the way we do things. And again, that's just proving really difficult to do. But equally, there's a positive thing here. I mean, there's a statistic from GCHQ, the UK intelligence agency, a few years ago that said 80% of security breaches could be stopped by just having good basic security right. So we can get a bit overwhelmed sometimes and think, oh, there's all this stuff out there, I can't do anything to help. But actually, just that good basic discipline, and there's lots of good practice out there about what that means, can get every business really long way there. So we shouldn't give up on that, and just, it's a really good place to start of getting those basics right. So moving on to the final slide, I just wanted to highlight our latest report, the Audit Insights Cybersecurity 5 years on, effectively, and that's free to download for anyone on icaw.com/cyber. And what we were doing, really, our fifth report, was reflecting on how things have changed over the last 5 years. We've been talking about cybersecurity a lot, but have things actually got any better? And we came up with a number of key themes. Firstly, absolutely, there have been lots of improvements. Lots of businesses are spending more time, spending more money, and it's really gone up the priority of every size of business, just, I think, from all that personal experience. But there are equally many, many challenges, and organizations are still struggling. From the number of data breaches we see, we can still, you know, there's still lots of challenges out there. As far as large organizations are concerned, those legacy systems continue to be a real problem. Just things like patching your software and keeping all that stuff up to date is really hard. And things like WannaCry, that kind of attack, is targeting organizations who haven't patched their systems. And for a lot of large organizations, particularly those with that complicated legacy architecture, it's a real struggle. That communication with boards continues to be a problem. We've certainly seen boards get a lot more educated. They've got access to a lot more expertise. But having those meaningful discussions with the security experts, really understanding where to spend money, where the value is, whether they're doing enough, that, you know, those conversations are still, you know, challenging, and there's still improvements that can be made there. And then that point about basic discipline, you know, the need to have that basic discipline. And yes, it's time consuming and you know, difficult, but, you know, there's still an awful lot that most organizations can do to get that right. And then finally, we have all these new challenges emerging, new standards, new regulations. Certainly in the EU, we've got the new data protection rules, and that certainly has been a tremendous help in raising cyber up the agenda of everybody. We've had huge amounts of interest in cybersecurity in the last year or so as a result of GDPR. And it's going to be interesting to see as that, you know, as that pans out, how those improvements develop and change, and how that affects the rest of the world. And I know there's new regulations all around the world, particularly around personal data. And then there's that point around new technologies, because of course cybersecurity isn't something that stays still. It's always changing. And again, one of the points we make in our audit insights is it's not something you can do a risk assessment once a year. You tick the box, right, we're cybersecure. There's always change, and there's always new technologies. There's new innovations. There's the Internet of Things. There's AI. There's all this new stuff that's always coming along and creating new challenges for organizations. So that ability to respond, to be always proactive in looking at what's happening and thinking about cyber as an integral part of innovation is a key point. So those were the points that I wanted to make, and I'm happy to hand back to Bob and take any questions there might be at this point.
Thank you, Kirsten. That was excellent. And you hit on two areas that passwords, as you said, you know, it's IT is not just about the IT department anymore. Security is nowhere near just the IT, because it's the individuals in the organization who leave open the door. You know, IT can put the best locks in the world on the door, but if you leave the door open every time you walk in it. And passwords, I was just looked at a study that was done by a major university where they did an analysis of all their passwords that their students were using. And the word password, of course, itself was still the single biggest password that's being used, despite the fact that for the last probably 10 years, everybody said, don't use password, everybody uses it. The favorite words were, I love you, because people want to go to phrases. Fortunately, it was better than hate. Hate was mentioned very few times, but love you was mentioned probably the most. And the ability to, when they started analyzing the students' passwords, amazing the number of them that were the same as a number of other people. So they grouped them. It was a very interesting study. But between that and phishing, I think those are the two biggest ways people can leave the door open. So we've got a couple of questions for Kirsten. And the first is, what are you seeing in the biggest gaps in cybersecurity as it matures?
I think just looking at, if we look back at the audit insights and we look at kind of the leaders, we always tried really hard to separate out what are the leaders doing and, you know, what do the others need to learn from that? And I think ultimately it comes down to leadership. I think that's actually the biggest gap, and the biggest thing is the leadership recognizing two things. One is this is critically important. Actually, this needs quite a lot of investment, time and effort. And when you look at the leaders, they are spending lots of money and lots of effort. They're investing in new technologies and AI, and they recognize that this is, you know, this is critical. This isn't just a box to tick. This is critical to their reputation and to the success of the business. And the second point is just recognizing the fact that this is always changing. This is about culture. This is about thinking about security differently, always recognizing the dynamic nature of it. It's continuous improvement. It's focusing on intelligence. It's kind of seeing this ongoing battle, not just, as you say, but a process and things to be ticked, because, you know, people struggle to follow that. It's a whole culture and a way of thinking. And actually that has to start at the boardroom, because often when you look at some of the people who are worst at following this stuff, they're boards who want to access all kinds of things on their iPads, and they, you know, and actually it has to start at boards, and they have to show that at that level they're taking all this kind of stuff seriously, and they're investing, and there are consequences for doing this stuff wrong, and it has to, you know, kind of focus at that level. And I think when we look at the leaders compared to everyone else, it has to, that's what they have more than anything else. So I think that's the biggest gap. And there's lots of things from that flow from that kind of recognition of seeing it as so important. And it's ultimately a cultural issue, not just about process.
All righty. As the cloud usage increases, the amount of sensitive data on the public cloud also increases. Do you see that as a significant risk, or are cloud providers sufficiently equipped?
I think cloud is certainly something we've talked a lot about to our members, and cloud security is always a big concern. I think what's always important to recognize in the cloud, when we talk to our members about cloud and security, you're kind of not comparing moving into the cloud with the sort of being in perfect security. What you're actually comparing it to is often a small business trying to do security themselves. And we'd usually say that, you know, in most cases, a cloud provider is probably better equipped to do good security than a small business who've got a computer in their office and they're having to keep things up to date themselves. And actually, cloud can be far more secure, particularly for smaller businesses. But of course, moving things into the cloud, you can't get rid of the, you know, you can't outsource your risk. You can move things into the cloud, but it still takes a lot of careful consideration, a lot of careful, you need to do due diligence. You know, and that's in itself a challenge because most cloud providers will, you know, often quite opaque about the sorts of controls and things they have in place. You've got to think in terms of risk management. What's the sensitivity of the data that I'm putting into the cloud? What do I know about it? And then you've got to think about all those controls around it. What's my resilience? What happens if the cloud goes down? So cloud is one element to it in terms of where the data is. And as I said, particularly for small organizations, actually, cloud may well be a safer environment than trying to do all of that yourself, but you can't get rid of the risk. You know, that's still, if something goes wrong, it's still going to be your responsibility. So there's all this due diligence and all that risk management you need to do around that. So that's sort of the message we normally go out with in terms of cloud to our own members.
Thank you, Kirsten. Kirsten will be available also to answer questions a little later on. We'll move on to our next session, but please don't forget to send in your questions, and the earlier the better. So next, we'd like, thank you so much, Kirsten. That was excellent, and I think you hit all the right points on that one. Next up, we're going to hear from George Quigley, who will be sharing his insights on how you can deal with cybersecurity from a business risk and resiliency perspective. George, the floor is all yours.
Thank you, and good morning, and good afternoon, and good evening to everyone from around the world. my first slide is a hiker stood on the edge of a precipice here. We could just go back one slide for a second. And it's just the reason I put this slide up is it seems to me that we're kind of looking for the answers to cybersecurity. And we're kind of seeing it as something specialist and looking out across this great vista, and we're not quite able to understand what it is. And we're looking for cyber risk rather than looking for what is actually staring us in the face, which is what we are facing here is a risk from the way that we're using technologies to run our business. And whilst cyber is a specialist area, it's nonetheless just effectively another business risk that we need to deal with. And I think the problem is, and this guy here is kind of disconnected a little bit from the world, is because I think that's how we look at cyber risk. We disconnect it from our businesses. We think it's just something separate, and we put in place sort of a generic one-size-fits-all approach, which for many businesses means that what we're doing is putting in place something that's too complex, too costly, it's not properly aligned to the risks that we face. And the result is we're either ending up spending too much or too little on cybersecurity and resilience, and we're not actually mitigating the risks that we face. And if we just all think for a minute about the Experian breach of some time ago, which when it first was announced as a very sophisticated breach and something that perhaps Experian couldn't do much about. And then we read the House Committee on Oversight and Reform and their report, which said it was entirely preventable and says it was down to a lack of governance, incomplete risk assessment and ineffective controls. And that word again, entirely preventable. And we are in a space of something, and just building on what Kirsten said, there are things that we can do to prevent an awful lot of the stuff that's happening, and somehow we are failing. So that was just to give a view. We're kind of looking into this void. If we now move on to the next slide, cybersecurity risk, I think, fits across four buckets for me. Make no mistake, cybersecurity is a complex problem. Okay, so the ability to approach it from multiple, often competing perspectives with multiple possible solutions makes it even more of a challenge. But we've got an ever-increasing business landscape. That's the first point. So increasing level of digital services, robotics, artificial intelligence. You know, we've got self-driving vehicles coming around the corner, which may revolutionize what we see in the taxi business. And if you just think a little bit about your business and how your business has changed over the last few years. Now, if you think about what it was like a decade ago and then try and imagine what we might face in the next decade, there's lots of complexity building here. I mean, I started my career in retail management, and we had to record our stocks all manually. Nowadays, it's all done, recorded automatically, and you can even check where your stock is. And for that that's perishable, you can even check whether the actual environmental controls on it in transit are actually working or not. So we've moved on immensely. So this idea that, you know, we are now in a landscape which is technology driven and brings with it a series of risks, and we just need to start thinking about those, and we just need to accept, as Kirsten said, that you can't just tick the box once a year on this. You have to keep thinking about how does this affect my business on an ongoing basis, which is why I've kind of drawn everything together here in a wheel. But if you look then at the next bit of the bucket, which is the involving threat actors and their techniques. And again, Kirsten had some of her slides on some of the things that we've seen. She talked a little bit about the British Airways breach. Well, interesting thing about the British Airways breach is that, and I would suggest that everybody on this webinar goes and has a look at RiskIQ. And the RiskIQ website's done quite a lot of work on this. And it's a group called, I call it MageCart. People have different pronunciations of it. But they will show you and tell you exactly how MageCart managed to do a lot of what they do. Now, the interesting thing that comes from that is that MageCart is not one group. It's a series of groups within it. They all use a similar technique, but they all use it differently. And they're all out there trying to get money and credit card details from a variety of sources. Effectively, what we've got now is we've got another big business in this world. That big business is called cybercrime. And cybercrime continues to grow and continues to evolve. And if anybody thinks that cybercrime is not there or not real or we haven't seen it and it doesn't affect us, let me tell you from personal experience that cybercrime and at top end, cybercriminals are real. I was subject to a verified death threat when I was working in one country looking at a hacking attack that had happened, and I had to be escorted out of the country very quickly by the security forces. It was something out of a Hollywood movie, which leads to a whole nother level of risk assessment. But this is real, it's growing, they're not going to go away, and we need to just keep that in the back of our mind. The other thing to think about here is that this risk is not just from technology, it's not just from people, it's actually a mixture of people, process, and technology. And we need to think across those buckets. So whether it's passwords or phishing, whether it's inappropriate patching of our technology, or whether it's our processes that are letting us down, we need to have a view across all three, which makes this slightly more complex. And a great example of the process point is I was asked to help a food retailer here in the UK who said they must have been hacked because every time they were putting out a promotion in the UK across their stores, then their competitors knew about the promotion probably an hour or two before they did, because every time they ran a promotion, they found that the competitors in the area ran the same promotion, but actually a better promotion, and had it up and running faster and quicker than they did. Now, when we got into the review, we found that there was no evidence whatsoever that they'd been hacked. And so the next question then was, how do you get this information out? How do you get things across to people with the various different promotions that you're running? And they said, quite simply, what we do is we don't give a great deal of time. We don't want this to be out in the wild for too long. We use SMS messages. They're relatively easy campaigns to run, and we can do them by SMS messages. Fine. Okay. How does somebody get an SMS message? They're on this list of people. Great. How do you take people off of that list once they've left your organization? And we were met with stunned silence. And what they suddenly realized was there's an awful lot of people on that SMS list who'd left the organization, who had gone to work from the competitors, who were receiving the SMS messages telling them exactly what the promotions were. And that's how they had been effectively breached. It was a process issue. So we need to think about people, process, and technology. The final bit for me, which I think makes this an issue even more of a challenge, and I alluded to it a little bit a minute ago in terms of experience, is the governance gap. Do we have enough understanding of cyber to be able to mitigate the risk? Do our technologists have enough understanding of our business risks in order to be able to help us mitigate our risks effectively and efficiently whilst allowing us to meet our business objectives? You know, we train managers to manage, we train leaders to lead, we train technologists to deal with technology. There's a huge gap between the two. And do we ever get the right advice from people with sufficient knowledge who can help us properly? Do we get the translators that sit in the middle to help us solve these problems? Because as Kirsten alluded to it, if we can resolve a significant amount of this risk by just doing the basics, why aren't we doing them? Why aren't we getting those basics done? Why do we still have people with passwords that say, I love you, or secret or QWERTY or 123456 or whatever they are. And some of those can be resolved by technology controls, but actually there's a bit of a governance gap here. So we need to start thinking about how we do our governance. And if we move to the next slide, just building a little bit on that governance process, I've built this slide in terms of what an accounting practice would look for, but you can use this and think about this across any type of business. So at the top, there's a little bit around how the technology, do you understand your technology and the risks in the context of your business? And from accountants, why is cyber not a priority? A lot of the things you'll hear is time constraints. We're too busy running the business or don't have the time, or it's a knowledge gap, or it's going to cost too much, and I've alluded to that already, or actually it's not really an issue. Or some people still think actually that they don't rely much on systems and applications, and therefore it's not really an issue for them. I have to say that last one is disappearing as we move forward in time. But the other four are still there, and those other four are still there for most organizations that I deal with and work with. And you know, I've worked with organizations, a small 8-person firm that is currently having extortion demands for some information that has been stolen from them. So when you talk about it costs too much, you know, you're going to pay the cost at some point in this process. Probably better to think about governance and make sure you're paying the costs at the beginning rather than at the end and avoiding some of these issues that we see. And on the right-hand side, just some of the issues for accountants to be concerned about. If we think about the data that we hold, if we think about the usage of our data, you know, we have deadlines we have to meet. It would be really interesting if somebody started to target accountants around tax year end and started to hit us with denial of service attacks so we couldn't reach our cloud providers and weren't able to put the filing across in the time. We'll probably take the hit, not the cloud providers and certainly not the criminals. So there's a number of things in here to just think about as how they might affect you and what you might have to deal with. And it's the same for businesses. And I do think accountants are actually in quite a good place to start talking to businesses about some of the governance issues. And I know Donnie's going to build on that later on. My final slide is just saying, if we look at this, how do we deal with this? What do we do? So on my final slide, I say, we have to, and it'll be no surprise, I've banged on it a couple of times already, but what we need to do is start with governance. If we start with governance, so on the shield on the left-hand side in the purple, if we start with governance, we work through our risk management, we then go through a number of technical issues and come out to resilience at the end, then we've started with governance and we've ended with resilience. And we should hopefully, as part of that process, get rid of some of the common issues that we've got, which come from phishing. Okay, they come from vulnerabilities that have existed for way too long and should have been patched. Those are two big areas where these things come from. There's a people element, but there's also a people element of insiders within the organization, as well as people external. So we need to think about how we've configured our systems. So that's around the systems management. But there's a slide there of the various different elements that we at Falcon say need to be thought of through this process. And not every organization needs to have every single one. So the risks are specific to you as an organization. They are a specific risk to your business that you need to deal with. How do you do that? Four stages on the right-hand side. First one is context. So build a picture of your firm, your people, your processes and technologies, which will give you the foundation to understand effectively how you operate. And linking back to Kirsten, how you operate and what your key assets actually are. Then you can start thinking about where the risks are, which will allow you to think about, well, what are the gaps in my current control framework, which will allow you to then put your transformation effort in place and actually put in place something that will solve this. So the context gives you a cost-effective solution. The risks help you to drive a practical approach. The gaps make it pragmatic, and your transformation leaves you in control, not someone else. And I appreciate that's a very quick whistle-stop tour through it. I've seen all sorts of issues across all sorts of businesses, from extortion of money, from stealing of IP, from harassment of staff, you name it, it happens across the piece. And I think fundamentally what I've seen over the years is there's a lack of governance in here. If we get the governance right and we start with it, then hopefully we will end with resilience. So thank you everyone for listening. I appreciate your time.
George, thank you so much. That was excellent. You hit on a lot of topics, and you actually answered some of the questions that were coming in as they came in. But I will just pick up on one of them that I think is important, and you somewhat touched on it also, which is the threats from internal. Many times we focus on cybersecurity, on keeping, you know, hackers out or people who are on the outside. But as our own government here in the U.S. learned about 2 years ago, it seems like it may have been longer, internal is just as bad as external. Taking information out of an organization and then distributing it on WikiLeaks or, you know, somewhere else for others to see and understand the entire workings of large organizations. Do you care to comment on that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, so for me, you've hit on my pet hate. I've grown to hate the term cyber risk and cybersecurity. And the reason I've grown to hate it is because when you say that, people automatically think of somebody externally trying to hack into systems. And you'll still get the view that that's a teenager in his bedroom or her bedroom with a can of Coke and a pizza just hacking into systems at random, as you see in Hollywood. The sad fact of it is that there is much more disruption that happens internally. We've had clients where they found that some of the development team have been using their bandwidth and their systems to run their own businesses, including adult businesses. So there's lots of reputational damage going on there. We've had people stalked. We've had people who will sell information. If you look at the BA issue, the Magecart group, there's only three ways they could have got the information onto the website. There was either a vulnerability on the website, there was either the default username or passwords, or they got a hold of a username and password. And you know what? Selling your credentials is many people see it as a good way to earn some money with limited risk. And what's the blowback on them personally? Probably nothing. And you see that continually. So I think internal risks are much more severe than people believe them to be. And I think it's because we need to start thinking about technology risk in all its guises, of which cyber risk is just a subset.
Thank you. I do want to answer one of the questions myself very quickly. It's non-technical. That is, the slides will be available afterwards on the global network of IFAC. So that was one of the questions. And then, George, you actually just hit on this one, too. You have a unique way of answering questions before they're being asked. No, I appreciate it. But what do you see, any changes in HR that are necessary as we go forward and even today to what are needed in both business and audit entities when we see so much technology? Do we see HR getting involved anywhere in addressing the type of people or the type of background checks, for instance, that they're doing on people?
Yes, and I think so. Interesting. That's a very interesting one. We're starting to see that trend now wider in organizations. So if you look from a UK perspective, financial services have always done background checks on individuals and continue to do so to quite a detailed level. You're now seeing certain organizations who are giving people access to certain levels of information, carrying out significant background checks before they employ them for that reason. You know, if I can get a job in an organization in a restricted or an area where there's sensitive information, or in fact in any business where there's significant information, then I can do lots with it. So I think that trend will continue, and it will continue to fall down from financial services through into large business first, then into smaller businesses.
Thank you. And thank you so much. It was a great session. We're running out of time on this one as far as additional questions, but again, we will have availability, hopefully at the end, to answer a few questions that as they continue to come in. And thank you again for sending in those questions. Next, we're going to hear from Donnie Shimamoto, who will be sharing his insights on SMP service delivery and cybersecurity, and how can we enable clients to manage cybersecurity issues. Donnie, it's all yours.
And I'll say aloha to everyone. Hawaii is my home, so it's great to be speaking with all of you today. Next slide, please. There we go, opportunities for small and mid-sized practices. So just to give a quick background for you, so I am an accountant, and I work with small and mid-sized businesses, and so that's what I'm really going to be giving you information about today, because a lot of firms, especially small and mid-sized firms, feel like they cannot do anything in this, that they are handicapped, and they're too small, and they shouldn't have to worry. And so next slide. So this is the perspective that I'm coming from, is really the small and mid-sized firm and the middle market clients that they serve. I wanted to start off first with really kind of bringing this home to the small and mid-size, and this SMB or small and mid-sized business was the subject of this Datto ransomware report. Now I'm going to have you take this with a grain of salt, because Datto is a backup services provider and they also provide disaster recovery. So they're looking at this ransomware report and they're providing information about ransomware report about ransomware and the risk from ransomware, which is what their solution happens to solve. But I think if we keep that in the back of our mind, their data points are right on and consistent with a lot of the other research we see in the market today. So malware, still a significant threat to small and mid-sized businesses, with ransomware still having the highest reported incidences. And as George mentioned, the end user error really is the common threat vector. And this end user is an internal person that is clicking on that attachment or clicking on that link that is then opening and then locking down the network. So despite all of the prevention measures that are put in place, we're still seeing this malware come across, and it's being able to take hold of these organizations. Now, I want to give you one example that really helps to bring this down to the small firm size. I have a firm that reached out to us it's been 2 years ago now, where they were a 20-person firm located in Houston, and they had just gotten hit with ransomware. And this was not just someone opened up some type of attachment. It was actually a very pervasive attack. They think that the attack actually started out at one of their client sites, so probably a smaller mid-sized business, where their auditor had been working on site, picked up the virus from the client's network. The auditor came back into the office, connected back into the firm's network. The virus moved into the firm's network. It moved from the workstation, the laptop, over onto the server. When it was on the server, it still didn't invoke. It waited until it got administrative credentials. It took those administrative credentials, went into the backup software, destroyed the backups, and then went and locked down the network. And so it was very, very like it waited, it knew it, where it needed to go, and it until it went and hit the backups, that's when it then said, hey, I'm gonna invoke and cause this issue. So this is definitely something small businesses, not an isolated incident, but we're seeing this in small businesses and then in smaller firms as well. The other scary thing about this incident was that the ransom that was requested was very, very close to the amount of cash that this firm had in its bank accounts. And so the owners think that perhaps they actually also got the banking credentials and knew exactly what to ask for. So scary. The other side of this ransomware is really about downtime. And it's about the downtime that's caused and how we're not going to have access to the information or to be able to do our work. And so we're going to continue to worry about that. When we look at the industries that are being hit the most severely from this, construction, professional services, including accountancies, finance and insurance, these are the ones that we're seeing the highest victimization rate. So all very near and dear to both our own professions as well as the clients that we serve. And the other thing that we're seeing is that these ransomware attacks are becoming more diverse. So before, people used to think, I'm on an Apple device, this is safe. Well, there's been a 500% increase in Apple OS attacks, still very much lower than Windows, but this threat is going quickly. So we can't be that I'm on Apple and by default I'm safe. The ransomware attacks are also starting to impact the cloud. So you heard both Kristen and George mention, you know, just because you're in the cloud doesn't necessarily mean everything is safe. And this is definitely true. Both Office 365 and G Suite and AWS all have had all different types of attacks against them that have crippled the small businesses that are operating using their suites. So really, as we look at this, it's beyond, again, an IT issue. It's also about business continuity and disaster recovery. These are our keys to really mitigating these ransomware threats. And business continuity in particular is not an IT issue. It's about exactly what it says, business. So we need to look at operations. We need to look at how will we continue to do business if our infrastructures are then impacted. Next slide. So here was some percentages. I'm not going to read through this, but I wanted you to have this information when you download the slides so that you can see the different ways that we're seeing these impacts. And you can see very high numbers, 79%, 63%, and 58% all looking at ransomware viruses and adware. So we're still seeing a lot on this. You're going to see in the slides that it references MSPs, and these are managed service providers. So these are the outsourced cloud providers of IT services to these small and mid-sized businesses. Next slide. So there's two major opportunities that we're going to see as we start to do this. And this is where I would encourage a lot of you to look at how do I actually provide education to your members around being able to leverage these opportunities. So the first of this is really about firms helping their clients quantify risks and the return on investment. Next slide. One of the biggest questions we always get is how do I actually know how much to spend? How much am I at risk? And so the Pony One Institute has a data breach study that they do every year. Part of what they do in this is they quantify the average cost per lost or stolen record. And so you can see here that from the 2008 study, that was $233 in the US. About a third of that is in the direct cost, which is what you're spending directly to minimize the consequences of the data breach and then to assist any of the victims. The other two thirds, $152 US in that, is in the indirect cost, which is a lot of, I think, of opportunity costs where you have employees redeployed to spend time on the data breach or to deal with customer service issues related to the data breach or even doing PR to help manage that reputational damage. Right, so that's two thirds of the cost is really coming from this indirect cost. There are a variety of factors that Pony One identifies as helping to that either impact positively or negatively this data breach. So deployment of security automations. Notice that even fully deployed security protections really only reduces the cost by 35%. I say only, 35% is actually quite a bit of reduction. It's over a third of that cost is reduced there. But even partially deployed security automation still will reduce it by almost a quarter of 23%. Incident response team, this is again, that's non-IT side. It's about what happens when we actually see a breach, almost a 10% decrease there. Encryption being one of the big ones and mandated by several of the different regulations related to privacy across many countries. Extensive cloud mitigation and the third-party involvement, you'll see both of these increase. Some people will use that data point and say, well, then I shouldn't be in the cloud. However, as Kristen and George had both mentioned, when you're in the cloud, if you've done good due diligence around your cloud provider, the actual risk of a breach actually occurring will be greatly decreased. So these increases that you're seeing here are really because you're going to have to coordinate with that cloud provider or any other third party to really understand what has actually been breached, what are the vectors, how do we actually go and do the forensics around it. So that does increase. I think of that as coordination costs. Next slide. So to quantify the actual impact to the organization, whether it's the firm or to a client, I encourage people to do these counts. So how many customers' private data do you have? Also, how many vendors or business partners' private data do you have, right? And private data could be any of these in the US, it would be social security numbers, so any of these tax identification numbers, any of the bank account numbers, credit card numbers, you know, all of these are going to count towards this private data. In addition, we're going to see health information and other ones also subject to privacy included in here. Okay, how many employees' private data do you have? People often forget that their employees are giving them their bank account numbers so they can pay them by direct deposit, and those are all subject to these regulations as well. So take the total of all of these individual counts and multiply them by 233. So even a small organization with just 200 records would have an potential exposure of almost $50,000 US. Take that up to 2,000 records, and now we're at almost $500,000 US. So this number grows really quickly, and it's this using this dollar amount or this average dollar amount is an easy way to quickly quantify how much am I at risk? How much will I spend to actually reduce this risk? The other one I would caveat on as you use these numbers, smaller organizations are probably going to need to multiply this number by two or three because they are not going to have the economies of scale to really leverage the volume and the costs across a wider base. And so again, smaller organizations, I always say multiply these numbers by two or three because that'll give you a better feel for your true exposure. And then in addition, it's really about the negative reputational impacts when you've had this breach. Will customers trust you with their data after they've had a breach? Next slide. So people often, the other thing to look at is really then this concept of return on investment. And we often think of this as, well, I'm spending money to prevent this breach from occurring. And so when we look at this, take that cost that you've just computed and look at it from two different ways. This privacy data breach where data has actually left the organization, and then you're going to be subject to things like GDPR or any of our US ones as well. The second way to look at this is then the loss of system access or operations. So it could be lost revenue because a system is down and you're not able to actually generate your revenue, or it could be lost productivity from your people not being able to work. And especially for our firms, this becomes important because if our people as service-based businesses, if our people are not working, not generating those billable hours, our firms are losing out on money as well. Then take that and compare that against the cost of these safeguards and these risk mitigation strategies. So the cost of implementing additional software or technology, you saw from the previous slide, that can be up to 35% reduction of the cost in the event of an incident. The cost of training and employee time. People, again, are our weakest link. So the more awareness that you can drive and train, you can provide them on what they should or shouldn't do, is going to be important in reducing this risk. And then lastly, the cost of cyber liability insurance. I'm at a point where I'm recommending that all firms have cyber liability insurance, because there is no firm that doesn't somehow operate in our cyber world, whether it's emailing with clients, whether it's exchanging files with clients, even if it's on a thumb drive. All of that is going to be subject to this cyber world or the cyber risk. And so the cyber liability insurance has come quite far in being able to provide the protections in the event that an incident actually occurs. The other way that I look at this is also really about really looking at the mitigation, because the cyber liabilities policies will also help many of our firms through actually mitigating the risks. Next slide. So the second opportunity is really about helping clients assess their governance and risk management. And you actually heard George say this quite a bit. This is a governance issue. And in small and mid-sized businesses, they really don't have the strong governance function, and they don't have the risk management expertise in-house. In fact, a lot of them, in effect, have the risk management outsourced, or at least their financial governance outsourced to perhaps a client accounting services provider that's within our firms. SMBs also usually outsource their IT department, which is what you saw in my MSP slides that we started off with. And most of these service providers also don't have strong risk management functions. Next slide. This slide will show you kind of the relationship between how IT governance or cyber governance and IT risk management plays across all of the different areas. So we've got our CEO and our business strategy at the top driving things. Driving really IT governance. And this is the piece that's missing often within the small and mid-sized business world, because this is not present. It goes straight down to the IT department. I have that in quotes because it may be a managed service provider that's actually doing that. And there should always be this healthy tension between IT risk management, which is looking at the risks and our strategies for mitigating those risks, against what IT is actually doing to enable people to actually do their work. In larger organizations, we're going to see the right side of this diagram come into play as well, where we've got IT internal audit looking back at governance and risk management and saying, are these things being done correctly or effectively? And then reporting that up to the audit and risk committees or board of directors. Next slide. The other way that I think accountants can help a lot of our clients is by doing process mapping to really understand where is information that is at risk flowing. And this may look overwhelming, but this is just the HR flow. And you can quickly walk through this to identify the systems the processes that are handling private information, and then where there are systems at risk. And you can see in the diagram, all we did was highlight those systems with yellow, saying these are the systems that have major privacy risk. So this can help people to identify where are things at risk, where do I need to improve my business processes. Next slide. There are also a variety of scopes of work for this. So this slide has four different types of assessments, purposely using the word assessment because it may not have assurance attached to it, but these are different ways of looking at whether we're looking at it at the governance level, governance and policy, or looking at it operationally to determine what's going on, including looking at the controls, effectiveness of controls. And you see I have the references there to the SOC reporting standards around SOC type 2s, in particular as we look at cybersecurity or privacy. Next slide. So really what we can really do is look at determining the risk of IT tolerance, the level of IT tolerance, risk tolerance, and the gaps. I like to use three standards. One, anything that's a gap between what's required of us as standards or compliance, generally we must fix these, and that's going to be prioritized the highest. Secondarily, gaps between management's risk tolerance and where the current environment is are things we should fix. And then things that get us all the way up to the top at best practices are what we consider nice to fix. And you'll see standard risk mitigation plan and efforts there. That is the thinking that we as accountants can bring in to our clients. And then lastly, it's helping to manage the organization's ongoing risk posture. Last slide, I believe. So that's wrapped there very quickly through, but I hope I gave you some very tactical examples of what firms can do to help our clients, as well as ourselves, really manage these risks.
Donnie, thank you. That was super informative. Also, the your point on the ransomware, so often the cost really is the cost to be closed down for whatever period of time it takes versus the actual payment itself. And I witnessed that last year with two clients. One was a major trucking company that was shut down for a week without the ability to communicate with their own drivers, except for phone calls. And then the other was a medical practice of five doctors who couldn't practice for a week. So you see that, and you see the effect on patients. They couldn't pull the records up. They couldn't run lab tests. IT is so critical, and it is that cost of being shut down while you're going through the process. Next, we're going to go right to Eric Askerson and Mimi Blanco Best, who are going to discuss what's been going on at the AICPA and how they're supporting their members around the world, actually, because with AICPA's connection with SEMA, it's helping business and members around the world. Eric?
Yeah, well, thanks, Bob. This is Eric Askerson. I'm the CEO of CPA.com, which is the business and technology arm for the AICPA, and it's great to be here with you all. In my role, I have the opportunity to meet with, the firms here in the United States as well as around the world. In the United States, there's 45,000 CPA firms. And what we're going to share with you are some of our activities related to helping these firms really build out practices related to cybersecurity. Maybe we'll talk a little bit about some of the things that they're doing to protect themselves. But when you think about cybersecurity, it is a fantastic business opportunity for the profession. I think we all think about the three big practice areas: accounting services, audit and assurance services, and tax services. But in many ways, there's four big services now, and cybersecurity clearly is a big service line. I can tell you there's a number of firms here in the United States that all they do is provide assessment and assurance related to cybersecurity. There's actually a top 100 firm that has over $50 million in revenue, and they don't do any financial statement audit work. They don't do any tax services work or accounting services work. All they work in is the cybersecurity space. So it's a fantastic opportunity. Secondly, the why. I think we've heard from the panel here about the why. I mean, there's huge threats out there. We've heard a lot of war stories. One thing that I like to reference at times is, the leader of the FBI here in the United States says there's two types of organizations, those that have been breached and those that will be breached, as the former FBI director. When we look, I'm going to be handing over to Mimi in a second here, but one thing that we've been doing at the AICPA is, thinking about history. And you think about history and the profession, and you look at the financial statement audit. And we didn't have the financial statement audit here in the U.S. really regulated until, the stock market crash of 1929. And at that time, there was assurance work being done, but, we moved forward with the regulators, and the financial statement audit came into play. And it really has served the financial markets so well here in the U.S. and around the world. And that's how we're looking at the whole cybersecurity space. how we're thinking about it now is what can we do for our firms around providing a blueprint, a common language that they can leverage with their clients. What you need today is an apples to apples comparison to look at these companies and how they're treating cybersecurity. So that's what Mimi is going to kind of give you an overview of. It's very exciting, the cybersecurity framework that we launched in 2017. And there's a lot that this foundation is based on. And she's going to talk a little bit about the SOC principles that Donnie just referenced. So with that, Mimi, I know you've got a few slides to walk the audience through these different activities.
Thank you, Eric. My name is Mimi Blanco-Best, and I work for the Innovation and Assurance team within the AICPA. And about 4 or 5 years ago, we started thinking about cybersecurity. Well, everybody started thinking about cybersecurity a little bit more. And we were thinking about what's the best way that the AICPA could basically serve the public interest in cybersecurity. And if you can go to the next slide, please. And we were thinking, first of all, that we believe in any market, the key to building trust is transparent reporting. So we thought whatever we do has to provide a process to encourage corporations, organizations to make transparent and consistent communications about their cybersecurity efforts. And the second thing we thought, as Eric said, and as history has shown, a CPA's opinion on management prepared information, like financial statements, has always seemed to be a great way to increase shareholders' confidence in the management prepared information. So we thought, again, whatever we develop has to provide a way that if CPAs are asked to do so, not requiring CPAs to do anything, but if the marketplace wants CPA involvement, whatever we develop has to have a means to do that. And out of all of this thinking, we came up with the cybersecurity risk management reporting framework. I want to tell you a little bit, if you'll go to the next slide, please, about that framework. First of all, it includes two different but complementary sets of criteria, the description criteria and the trust services criteria. The description criteria, the easiest way to think about it is almost GAAP for financial statement disclosures, except the description criteria tells you some of the things that should be disclosed about a company's cybersecurity risk management efforts. And it's interesting because many of the elements of those disclosures go hand in hand with many of the things that the earlier presenters were talking about. Some of the matters that are disclosed according to the criteria would be the principal types of sensitive information that a corporation owns, its major cybersecurity risks, information about its governance structure, its risk assessment processes, how it communicates cybersecurity information, not only throughout the organization to its employees, but also to individuals that need to know about it that are external, like customers and business partners and so forth. Information about how it monitors its controls. Information about its control processes, including key policies and processes. So basically what this description criteria is designed to do is to become a common language that managements of corporations can use to develop a narrative presentation of their cybersecurity efforts. So the next criteria, called the trust services criteria, basically can be used by management to evaluate the effectiveness of their controls to achieve the organization's cybersecurity objectives. But unlike a lot of frameworks that are out there today, the trust services criteria don't provide a checklist for companies that, for example, have to have these particular controls in place. Because as we talked about earlier, different controls are necessary at different organizations based on their specific risks. And these allow an organization to pick and choose which controls will best help them meet the outcome-based criteria that are reflected in the trust services criteria. So again, if management wants to, they can use those criteria to evaluate the effectiveness of controls and actually talk about that as part of their narrative presentation that they've prepared in accordance with the description criteria. So management can use those criteria to communicate information about their cyber resilience, if you will, to a broad range of stakeholders. And again, that's as far as it can go. If management wants to take that extra step and have a CPA examine their information and issue an opinion, the CPA would use the very same description criteria and trust service criteria. And by the way, many cases, we do know of certain cyber exams that are being done today, but more than that, there are a lot of what we call readiness engagements going on. For example, when we first introduced these criteria, many corporations weren't ready yet. Many organizations weren't ready yet for an assurance-based and attestation-based examination on their cybersecurity programs. So the CPA firm using the same criteria would go in and do what we call a readiness assessment and advisory service, basically to see where the gaps were and to help them determine what types of controls were necessary to fill those gaps. Next slide, please. So again, the objectives of an attest examination is to provide a CPA's opinion on both the description that's prepared by management and management's assessment of the effectiveness of controls within that program. Why? Again, because we believe that that CPA's opinion, as has been historically shown, will help enhance the credibility that shareholders can place in that management-prepared cybersecurity information. Now, keep in mind, again, just a couple of things. The engagement is totally voluntary. It's not mandated. It's not regulated. It's appropriate for any kind of business. It's organization-wide. We do think it would help reduce uncertainty and build resiliency in organizations by encouraging them to evaluate the effectiveness of their existing cybersecurity processes and controls. And we believe that it would permit flexibility because it doesn't constrain management to follow a particular cybersecurity framework in their efforts. Next slide, please. So what does a report look like that comes out of a cybersecurity examination? Well, first, it includes that management-prepared description that we talked about a few minutes ago. It also includes today a management assertion, which is basically a statement that it has prepared the description in accordance with the AICPA's description criteria, and it has evaluated controls in accordance with the trust services criteria. And finally, the practitioner's opinion on those same two elements. Next slide, please. So sometimes when we talk about the SOC to cyber, the examination, we call it a SOC for cybersecurity. SOC stands for System and Organization Controls, and the AICPA has a host of a suite of what we call SOC services. Donnie alluded to some of those in his presentation. SOC 1, 2, and 3 are for service organizations. SOC 1 is service organization controls when they're relevant to users, entities, internal control over financial reporting. And SOC 2 reports are relevant to controls over the security, availability, processing integrity, confidentiality, and privacy. We also are almost finished with a new service that we're calling SOC for Supply Chain, which is going to be very similar to a SOC 2, except instead of limited to service organizations, it's going to relate to controls at a manufacturer, producer, or distributor of tangible or intangible goods. So over the years, we've seen a dramatic increase in the demand for SOC services in this country, in particular SOC 2 engagements. And the AICPA is really beefing up, if you will, its efforts in this area. We are coming up developing new and better training programs, webcasts, podcasts, all sorts of things to help practitioners perform these types of engagements more effectively and efficiently. We're also working with other countries that have also seen an increased demand on these types of services. This year, we actually added an appendix to the new SOC 2 guide that talks about how a CPA could perform a SOC 2 examination under both U.S. and international standards and report accordingly. And we're also looking at new opportunities all the time in related areas. For example, as many of you talked about earlier, and those of you in European countries know, with the advent of the GDPR, data security and data privacy has become all of a sudden a huge focus for many. And we're looking at ways that we may be able to help practitioners design an engagement and report just on a company's data security efforts. So that's a lot of the information or a lot of the things that we're doing in the AICPA to try to help our practitioners help their clients with their cybersecurity needs. And the last slide shows you a website where you can go learn more information about everything that we're doing. In addition to this one, I also encourage you to go to aicpa.org/SOC, which is our full suite of SOC services, including cybersecurity, for more information on everything that we're working on here.
Well, thanks, Mimi. That was excellent. I'm going to make one concluding comment, then hand it back over to Bob for questions. Just want to state again that, you know, this cybersecurity attestation report initiative that the AICPA is undertaking is very significant. In some ways, we think is as significant as what happened in the 1930s with the evolution of the financial statement audit and what that did to financial markets, as I stated at the opening. It's all based upon the success that we've seen with these service organization control reports. The marketplace wants the profession, CPAs, to play this role. So this opportunity is there for us. One other area that no one's mentioned today, which also needs a lot of cybersecurity in it, is the whole blockchain crypto asset market. And I can tell you that's another, just every category as it evolves, requires assurance, and there's real opportunities for the overall profession to play leadership here, Bob.
Thank you both to both of you. Actually, thank you, Mimi. It was very good, and
we got you one. More than
well. I'm going to open up the mics for everyone as we go through. We have about 5 or 6 minutes left here before we have to wrap up due to our time frame with GoToWebinar. But I do want to ask everyone to be cognizant of the fact there's a very brief survey at the end, which helps us plan these. The technology advisory group looks at your responses very seriously to be sure that we're meeting the needs of our members, and the members need to let us know what if there's other topics they want to know. But this survey really does help us. So it'll pop up at the very end at around about 6 more minutes, because everybody's on a different time frame around the world. One question, and I'm going to take the first shot at it, but feel free to any of the rest of you to jump in on this one, and that is cybersecurity attestation. Does this overlap with SOX audit? And this is SOX, which is Sarbanes-Oxley here in the U.S., not SOC, which is a standard. So I have to be careful, because some people refer to both of them as SOX, and they don't that we can't show you any other slides on this particular question, I want to make sure everybody understands they're talking about SOX. And the answer is, does it overlap? Well, systems and controls certainly does play into SOX. And I do think that this does play a major portion, because if you've got a very weak security system within an organization, it certainly opens up that organization to risk. But I, would the rest of you would like to take any other points on this one, feel free to join me on this answer, and then we'll go to the other questions. Nobody else cares?
No. It's Donnie. I'll jump in. For the if that's SOX and Sarbanes-Oxley, the other thing to notice for SEC-regulated clients is that they now have required disclosures, including that it includes in the quarterlies of the risk management practices related to cyber. So it's definitely relevant.
Okay.
Yeah, and finally, I think the SOX audits focus primarily on controls that affect financial reporting, whereas cybersecurity goes much beyond just those controls. Although, again, many of them, like you said, Bob, could be the same. Cybersecurity focuses on a much broader set of controls that in many cases are, for example, operational compliance related as opposed to just financial reporting related, if that makes sense.
Sure does. Next question we have is one that I think many of you have touched on briefly, but I do think it is critical, and everything that I read on cybersecurity always goes to this point, and that is, what is the role of the board of directors in relation to cybersecurity? I'll start off by saying, clearly, like everything in business, the tone at the top is critical. And if the board is not seen as addressing cybersecurity, if there's not people who are presenting to the board, and the board's understanding cybersecurity issues within the organization, by and large, most organizations would be very weak in that area. And I think that it's critical that the board set the tone. It's no different than fraud risk. Fraud risk exists when you don't have tone at the top. If anybody else would like to hit this one, George, I think you briefly mentioned it also, and I see your mic is open, so please feel free.
And the board is, you know, what does the board do for anything? It provides that layer of governance. It makes sure the right resources are deployed in the right areas to address the risks that the organization faces is part of what they do. It's really interesting because I'm working on a project at the minute which has been driven by, this is again a financial services one, but the regulator, and it will tie into the question, but the regulator has asked, how does the board get the relevant management information to be able to make the right decisions on the cybersecurity risks that they face because they cannot see it? And I think that gives you an idea of where the regulator is coming from. The regulator is saying, if the board does not get the right information on this risk, does not understand it, and cannot give the right governance and play the right role in making sure that the risks are mitigated in the appropriate manner, then you've finished before you've even begun. So it's really, really important. That oversight role is critical.
Yeah, and hey, Bob, I just want to add one other comment related to the board here. There's what we're seeing there could be a convergence. When you think about auditing in the future, and you think about what's going to happen with looking at full data sets and leveraging artificial intelligence and looking at the integrity of the data in the financial statement audit, and then you look at cyber, Bob, this is something we've spoken about, there's going to be convergence in some ways of those two categories. So that's one, again, and sometimes I say the CPA profession, the CA profession, just the accounting profession is going to have an opportunity for leadership here. But the board, this is one of the big five or six areas the board needs to look at, you know, financial information, technology controls, you know, talent, business strategies. This is absolutely a board level topic, and there's just going to be more overlap with those other topics that the board thinks about every day.
I can actually see that some of the board members from IFAC are on, and our own vice president, Alan Johnson's on the call today, or on the webinar today, and to show that we're taking, he's taking it seriously because he comes from a large corporate and two larger organizations in his career, and obviously IFAC is taking this seriously also at its own board level. One quick question.
Yeah, I guess if I could add, go ahead, Bob.
That was Kirsten, wasn't it? We lost her.
It was Mimi.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was just gonna add that you know, a lot of the AICPA's framework is based on the COSO framework that was developed in 2013 by the Treadway Commission. And of course, it puts at the top of its framework the importance of the board of directors and what makes an effective board. So again, our criteria that we developed is aligned to the COSO framework. So it gives great importance to an organization's board and how they manage cybersecurity risks within that organization.
Can I just add here quickly, this is Kirsten, just a key point that came out in our audit insights is who on the board is sort of leads responsibility in this. And this, again, is quite a good indicator of how the board's thinking about this. Certainly 4 or 5 years ago, the boards were typically looking to the CIO as the kind of the person to lead on this. So where is the leadership? Is the CEO? Is the CIO? Is the tech side? So kind of where is the leadership and who is leading on the board on these issues? Or is it everyone seeing it as a core part of what they do? So I think that's kind of the next step is absolutely critical for the board, but who's taking the lead and how is that playing out across all the different responsibilities of board members?
And to add to that, one of the slides that I had showed the relationship between all the different functions. And so that slide on the far right of that slide showed the internal audit function reporting up to an audit or risk committee that is then reporting up to the board. So organizationally, that slide actually comes from our National Conference of Lawyers and CPAs, where I adapted some of our discussions around cybersecurity and the role of the board. So operationally, that's how we would see that play out as well.
I'd like to thank everyone. Don't forget the survey again at the, which will pop up here very shortly. We've run out of time, but I do appreciate everyone sticking to their time today. And we have still a number of questions we can't answer, but we do appreciate everyone's involvement in submitting questions. And with that, we would like to thank you and say goodbye.